नमस्कार एंड गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी। आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू वंस अगेन टू दिस वेबिनार सीरीज ऑन वेस्टर्न फिलॉसफी। बिफोर मेकिंग इनरोड्स इनटू टुडेज वेबिनार, आई विश all the participants and the members of philosophy family a very happy and prosperous new year. Hope that this year too would be doing a lot of philosophical activities in the family that would mark as an advancement over what we have done in the last year. We are planning to make sincere efforts to make the events in the family more focused and worthwhile. By the divine blessings, we think of doing better and better in the days to come. Now, well, during the last talk of Professor Pramod Kumar Das, who spoke on intellectuality, morality, and spirituality with reference to the philosophies of Descartes, Spinoza, and Leibniz. Well, I was, due to some personal reasons, I was absent on the day. I'm not synopsizing what he has talked on that day. Well, but today, Professor Das will be speaking on spiritual unity and diversity with reference to the philosophy of Leibniz. So let us all move to Professor Pramod Kumar Das for his lecture on the scheduled topic. Now, wishing one and all a very happy and prosperous new year, let us all move to Professor Das for the lecture. Thank you.
Namaskar. To all of you, I wish a very happy new year to all of you. Respected Dr. Rao, very esteemed participants of this session, I know very well that because today everyone is in busy in celebrating New Year, so we have very less participants. But today we have a very beautiful topic, that is spiritual unity and diversity. So this very title suggests that among the diversities, if you have one particular entity, one particular, that entity represents the whole reality. So this is the topic today. So even if there is only one participant, one, suppose there is only Dr. Rao and myself, whatever can be talked to 1,000 participants, 1 lakh participants, 1 crore participants, the same thing can be talked to a single person, and that single person, that particular entity, is equal to the whole entity. This is the philosophy of Leibniz. So here we are not concerned with a number. We are concerned with the essence. The essence of the totality is found in the essence of a particular entity. The essence of the whole ocean is found in a single drop of water from that ocean. The essence of the entire blood content of our body is equal to the essence of a one drop of blood of our body. So whatever is in the whole, that is also present in each and every particular. Suppose there is nobody to listen, there is nobody to listen, then you speak to yourself. That is called self-reflection. Nobody is there to listen to you. You practice this habit of speaking to yourself. That is a great spiritual sadhana, that one man can speak to himself. That the speaker himself is the audience, is the listener. If I can't listen to myself, then it cannot be understood by others. That means the external reality, the external audience, anything external is already present in the internal. The internal and external are not different. So every unity is self-sufficient, is so well organized that the second entity is not necessary to help the first entity to express the whole reality or totality. Every part is sufficient, uniquely organized, that it can represent the whole reality. So in the last class, last session, we were discussing about intellectuality, morality, and spirituality. These are the three human possibilities. Human consciousness is reflected in these three possibilities. Man is claimed as an animal, simply an animal. Many great philosophers, they have claimed that man is just like an animal. Whatever animals do, man does. Animals have anger, animals have hunger, animals have fear, animals have sex. All these things human beings have. So man is an animal. And it is true, it is fact, it is natural. Thomas Hobbes in the West, he claims that man is sensuous by nature. Man is just like an animal. Gilbert Ryle and so many philosophers, they have claimed so. And in Indian tradition, Charvak, that man is just like an animal, a very intelligent animal. So, and this life is the only life. So don't pass away your life, don't lose your life for any great philosophy, for metaphysical speculation, for wisdom. This is all nonsense, because time is passing away. Every day, the day of death is being counted. So if this is the only life, let us enjoy this life. Pleasure is the only standard of morality. If any action that gives you pleasure and maximum pleasure, that action is a moral action. So here pleasure is a value of life. Human actions should be pleasure oriented. So man is an animal. The next development, the next transformation, we can say that man is a rational animal. Yes, man is an animal, but he is a different type of animal who has rationality, who can discriminate from right from wrong, good from bad. Man has discriminative knowledge. So man is a rational animal. But what is the problem? Being rational is not necessarily being moral. One may be highly intelligent, but he may not be moral. And moral irrationality may be used and misused. Reason may be used and misused. So by misusing reason, by misusing rationality, we can justify bad as good, wrong as right. If our argument is satisfied by reason, by the logical rules, then that is accepted, irrespective of the fact that whether it is true or false. So logic is not concerned with the truth and falsity. Logic is concerned with the validity and invalidity of our thought process or argument. All the propositions may be false, but the argument is valid. That means logic is interested in validity of an argument, not the truth and falsity of a statement. In inductive way of thinking, we deal with the material truth, we deal with the experienced truth, but that ends with probability. That also does not give us guarantee about the truth, because it is quite impossible to perceive all phenomena. We can't perceive all examples, all instances. Therefore, there is a gap between premise and conclusion. So, by deductive process, we can't establish truth. And by inductive process, we can't conclude the truth, that this is truth. Because any description, any generalization is subject to revision. It is probable. We can't give guarantee on the conclusion of the inductive logic. That generalization cannot be guaranteed. So this is the point, that man is a rational animal, but a rational animal may not be a moral animal, may not have a moral consciousness. So the next phase is, man is a moral, rational animal. That means there is a possibility that man is an immoral, rational animal. This possibility is there. So the next transformation is that not only man is a rational animal, but also man is a moral, rational animal. But this is also a limit. This has also limitation. What is morality? How can we decide that this action is moral? Morality can be morality is also not the highest perfection of human life, because it is contextual. It is based upon reason to some extent. One action is moral from one perspective in one context, and that action is immoral from another context. So the customary values are subject to change. That change from society to society, custom to custom, country to country, place to place, time to time. So it is contextual. So in order to understand the contextuality of morality, one has to transcend the moral dialectics. this is good or this is bad, this is right or this is wrong, one should not be confused. As Arjuna was confused in the battlefield, what is good? Whether fighting is good or not fighting is good, this was the confusion. So morality is also a source of confusion. In a crossroad, we are confused, actually what is good, what should be done and what should not be done. Therefore, one should have the knowledge of the totality. One should transcend all the opposite possibilities. One should not be trapped by a particular fixed rule, ethical rule, like a categorical imperative of Immanuel Kant. Whatever may be the consequences, duty should be done for the sake of duty. No. Whatever may be the consequences, this is not so mathematical. Whatever may be the consequences, I shall speak the truth. No. You can't say so. If you say so, you are not social. If you are really social, if you really live in the empirical world, you can't say so. Whatever may be the consequence, no. Man should be conscious of the consequence. If that consequence is detrimental for the society, detrimental for humanity, detrimental for a country, that should be avoided. So we should be ready for the change. We should be ready for the change of our ethical paradigms. If we are not ready, if we claim that I shall do this, whatever may happen, let that happen. No. Categorical imperative is not so mechanical, it is good in mathematics, but it is not good in the empirical world. In the empirical world, we have to do our duty in a given context. That is called Swadharma. Therefore, in Indian philosophy, in the Bhagavad Gita, the absolutism and relativism, these two are synthesized. That yes, I am conscious of the absolute principle. I am conscious of the absolute paradigm that telling truth is virtuous. I know that. But in this context, I shall not tell the truth because it is bad for the society. My telling truth will harm the society. If so, then I should be mentally ready to go with the context. This flexibility should be there. So my Swadharma means my dharma, my duty in a particular context. So Swadharma does not negate the absolute dharma. Does not negate. That I understand. The telling truth is virtuous. But in this context, I shall tell lie. But it is end specific. It is not that I desired, I used my free will, now I am free to tell lie. No. It should have an end. It should be end specific. What is the end of my telling lie? If the end of telling lie is for Lokasangraha, is for the well-being of the society, then this can be accepted as the virtuous. If my telling truth is detrimental for the society, is harmful for the society, then that is unethical. That cannot be accepted as ethical. So man should be practical. Man should be pragmatic. So who will decide? Who will decide that when shall I tell lie? When shall I tell the truth? Who will decide? So if we will be trapped by moral principles, moral prescriptions, without having the spiritual grooming, the spiritual discipline, then we can't get any help. Morality can't help us. So morality should be guided by spirituality, that I am self-conscious. I witness the context. I witness the conditions. I witness the relativity. Who is saying that this is relative to that? Who is saying that Jagat is mithya? Who is saying that these are all forms? That formless witness, that pure consciousness is the witness of all the modifications of consciousness. So one should be established with that pure consciousness, that I am the witness. I am the witness of my thoughts. I am the witness of my prakriti, sattva, raja, tama, these are the prakriti. Every behavior is a product of our prakriti. Whenever we are found in a particular mood, in a particular, in every particular moment, every action is nothing but the manifestation of our prakriti. Either it is the manifestation of a sattva prakriti, or it is the manifestation of a rajasic prakriti, or it is the manifestation of a tamasic prakriti, it is definitely a manifestation of prakriti. But if there is not an inner mechanism, that if there is not an witness, who can perceive my prakriti? I have a prakriti, that's all right, it's natural. I am getting angry, that's natural, but I should know that I am getting angry. That first I is self-conscious I, that is the witness. That I is the witness of the second I am angry, number one. Number two, I am conscious that I am angry. These two statements describe two types of activity. I am angry, but I don't know that I am angry. That means I am trapped by my prakriti, that is anger. If I am conscious that I am angry, then my anger is only meant for a purpose. That means I am controlled. That means I am conscious. Anger is there, but the mental stability is also there. That means I am intelligently handling my anger. Intelligently I am managing my anger. The management of anger should be there. Anger is necessary, but the management of anger, how, in what quantity you should get angry, and when to react and when not to react. Who will decide this? Who will understand the context? Who will change our behavior? That is the higher consciousness, that is the pure consciousness. That means the higher consciousness is the witness of the lower consciousness. This is there in everybody. If we sit silently in meditation, just speak to yourself, just remain silent, ask to yourself, observe yourself, witness your thoughts, you will see there are two movements. One is the bodily movement, psychological movement, psychophysical movement, and the other is the spiritual movement. That means two eyes are there. One eye in brackets, it's pure consciousness, that is the witness of the second eye. I am a teacher, I am a father, I am a student. I am sleeping, I am waking, I am running. This second I is the knower, the actor. But the first I is neither knower nor actor. That is only the witness. So intellectuality, morality, and spirituality. Man is an animal, man is a rational animal, man is a moral rational animal, and man is a spiritual, moral, rational animal. So from our animality to spirituality, there is a long journey. We can't jump from this station to that station. Many great philosophers, they are satisfied with their animality. That I am a best animal. I should enjoy this life to the fullest. Man is an animal. Rationalist philosophers claim, they say, no, I can think. Cogito ergo sum, I think. That thinking is very much necessary. And this is my privilege. I can think. Therefore, I am intellectual. I am intelligent. I am rational. He claimed so. So he started with intellectuality and also he ended in intellectuality. Being intellectual is not moral. Therefore, Spinoza, he developed intellectuality to morality. Because morality is the higher dimension of human possibility. Man should be moral. If you are moral, then you can use your rationality in the right direction. You can't misuse your rationality. Being intelligent is not being moral. Being highly educated is not being moral. A doctor is highly educated, very much skilled, but he steals the organs from other patients. Very educated, because an intelligent doctor can only steal. An innocent doctor can't do this work. So here man is rational, but he is not moral. Arjuna was not irrational. Arjuna was very much rational. Arjuna was a wise person. Arjuna was very much intelligent. Arjuna was fit for any possible war. He was a warrior. But he did not have this higher rationality, which is equal to morality. That dharma, fighting is meant for dharma. Whoever commits mistake should be punished. Whoever destroys dharma should be punished. And anyhow, dharma should be protected. If dharma is not protected, nobody will be protected. Dharma rakhyati rakhitah. This rationality was not with Arjuna. This is the higher rationality. So the higher rationality is morality. So Spinoza, Descartes started with intellectuality. Beautifully, he introduced a new method, universal doubt, that mind should not accept anything dogmatically without suspecting it, without doubting it. And in the process of doubt, Descartes established that the doubter must exist, that doubter is the thinker, so I think, therefore I exist. In this way, deductively, he established the existence of a God, the existence of world, everything. But this is an intellectual exercise. But that does not reach the state of morality. As man is an animal, man is a sensuous being, appears to be unsound. Similarly, man is an intellectual being. It is also not so pleasant to hear that man is a rational animal. Being rational and not being moral is useless. So one should be moral. So Spinoza developed morality. Spinoza said, our moral character should be like geometry. आज देयर मे बी स्मॉल ट्रायंगल और बिग ट्रायंगल, द प्रिंसिपल इज मेंटेन्ड इन ऑल टाइप्स ऑफ ट्रायंगल्स दैट द सम टोटल ऑफ द थ्री एंगल्स इज इक्वल टू टू राइट एंगल्स. In a small triangle, this is found. In a big triangle, this is found. The triangle in Mumbai that have that quality, the triangle that is in America, in any space, wherever there is a triangle, this quality must be there. See, that is the moral character. As mathematics does not fail. As geometry does not fail, they always maintain their qualities. Similarly, human beings should not be deviated from the moral order. As the cosmic order, the Rita, that does not fail. Nobody is regulating cosmic order. It is regulated by itself. Similarly, the moral order, which is regulated by human beings, should not be deviated. Man should be committed to morality like mathematics and geometry. So Descartes promised one thing, that mathematics should be reflected in philosophical thinking. Philosophical thinking should be mathematical. In addition to that, Spinoza said, not only philosophical thinking, but also human behavior, human character, human practical living must be mathematical, mathematically true. Leibniz said, morality is not enough. Let us have a better metaphysics. The more your metaphysics is rich, the more your morality is so profound. So let us have a better metaphysics. We have to be strong in our metaphysical conviction. So what was the metaphysics of Descartes? Descartes said that, and Descartes' philosophy is common sense philosophy, that we experience two things. One is the extension and the other is thought. These two things are experienced by human beings. And in relating to these two, there are two substances. If thought is the property, it must have a substance, that is mind. If extension is a property, then that must have a supporting substance, that is matter. So body and mind are two substances. They are independent substances because matter is not conscious. Consciousness is not matter. That means extension cannot be explained by consciousness. Consciousness cannot be explained by matter. It's very natural. This is common sense. This is not philosophy. This is common sense view. That matter is matter and consciousness is consciousness. Matter is not explained by mind, therefore matter is distinct. Mind is not explained by matter, therefore mind is distinct. So there should be one higher principle in which these two distinctions should be merged. That is God. So God is both extendent and thoughtful. God is both conscious and extendent. Matter is extended but not conscious. Consciousness is, mind is conscious but it's not extendent. But these two possibilities are there. So these two possibilities should be merged in a higher principle, that is God. And Descartes said that that higher principle should be such a principle in which nothing will exist. In which nothing will exist. That means that God will remain as the creator. And the mind and the body and the intermodification of mind and body, the entire universe is created. So there is a dualism between the creator and the created. God as the creator, God as the first cause, that can't allow anything to exist in it. So God is independent of all existence, and God is the creator of all existence. So that is a relation between creator and creation, creator and created. So this is the dualism. But Spinoza says that my God is not the creator. My God is not foreign to this universe. My God is not the creator. My God is identified with the whole nature. The entire universe is nothing but the manifestation of that God. This is nothing but manifestation. This is not that God is the external cause. It is the higher principle who has created the entire universe. Why? If somebody will be the creator, he will blackmail. In our family, if somebody is the earning member and all others depend on them, then some power, some authority, his will work, father's will work because he is father, because he is earning. So if God is the creator, God is personal, and God has his own will. According to his will, as he willed, so he created this world. And everything is there according to the will of God. This is Descartes' view. Because Descartes had fear for Christian theology. They had fear. Descartes had fear. Therefore, he designed God as the creator and he accepted the will power, the will that God can have will. This is the desire of God. This is the will of God. Out of his will, he has designed this creation. Spinoza said, "My God is not a religious God. I am not going to satisfy any Christian theology. I am an independent philosopher. My God is not a religious God, and my God has no will to create the world. My God is the all-inclusive entity. And that is proved not by the fear of any theology, but from this geometry." Spinoza says, my God, the notion of a God is derived from geometry, from mathematics. So my God is an intellectual God. Descartes' God is a religious God. So when Spinoza is speaking of monism, or abstract monism and pantheism, Spinoza is not taking the concept of a God in a religious sense. Spinoza is explaining the relation between the unmanifest and manifest in the mathematical way, in the geometry way. As in all types of triangles, the same entity is found, that the sum total of the angles is equal to two right angles. As triangle is a modification of the empty space, the whole space, triangle is a form, circle is a form, square is a form. Similarly, this world of diversity is the modification of, is the manifestation of that substance. And whatever is found in that substance, that is found in its manifestation. So substance is one, and that one substance has infinite attributes, innumerable attributes, and each attribute has its modification, and the world we perceive is only a possible world out of many possibilities, because so far as our epistemology is concerned, we cannot see the total reality, whole manifestations, because human mind is limited to perceive only the two attributes of the substance. Human intellect can perceive only two attributes, mind and body, thought and extension. That means the other attributes which are not perceived by man, that is the area of human ignorance. So the world we live in, that is the world of our perception. That is the world. There is a saying in Oriya, Kupamanduka. So we are all the frogs in a well, because our mind is so limited, we can grasp only two attributes and their possible modifications. And in that also, we are not complete. We have still ignorance. So we have ignorance in ignorance. So beyond our knowledge of the two attributes, the possible attributes are there, and the possible modification is there, about which man is ignorant. That means metaphysically, the one substance is there. Metaphysically, the manifested jagat is there, but epistemologically, man can know only the part. The part possibility, whatever is possible to perceive, man can perceive. Whatever is not perceivable, whatever is not possible for man to perceive, that is left. So we manage with a part perception, we manage with a partly perceived world. This is the problem of Spinoza. Spinoza beautifully said about the one substance, attributes and modifications. But Spinoza claimed that it is not accessible to human understanding. Human intellect can only know two attributes of the infinite attributes. That means the whole reality will remain unexplained. I am repeating, if human mind can know only two attributes, that means the entire possible attributes and their modifications, the all possibilities of manifestation remain unexplained. Because it is only the human possibility that man can realize, man can know. So human mind is limited. But in Advaita Vedanta, the situation is just reverse. They don't say, even Immanuel Kant also says that, not like Advaita Vedanta, but like Spinoza, that human intellect can understand the reality only through space and time and through 12 categories of understanding. Whatever is known through these instruments, that is human knowledge, and that is the phenomenal world. So the noumena is unknown and unable through this process. Through this process means through human format, through human mind. This Immanuel Kant also said that. In Indian philosophy, Jaina system said that. That you can't see the whole elephant. If you try to say, then that will not be accepted because you are a blind person. Your knowledge is blind. You have a blind pursuit of the truth. Therefore, your knowledge is empty. Your knowledge is relative. You can't give a complete ready-made description about the totality because you are blind. So the great mistake is mistaking the part as the whole. If you see the part, if you see the part and judge about the whole, this is the mistake. And that is ignorance. We all do that. We see a person and speak of his personality. We speak a person in the marketplace. That is our first meeting. Then we speak of his personality. And personality is a very big thing. Personality means his total manifestation. I don't know that person. So my relation with a student is a particular relation. From that I can't assess his or her character. But we do that. Similarly, in this life, if any moment is disturbed, if any moment is a moment of failure, we give the whole judgment that the life is meaningless and that man commits suicide. Taking the part as the whole, because the situation will change. Your unhappy moments will become a moments of happiness. Failure will become success. Failure is not understood, therefore it is failure. After some days you will realize, oh, that was not really my failure. That was a blessing in this case. When some passengers did not get seat in the Titanic, they thought that we are very unlucky that we could not travel. But when they found the news that if that was a tragic with Titanic, and everybody died in the ocean, that was a blessing in disguise. So we don't know whether it is a blessing or a curse. So the part experience should not be mistaken as the whole. This is the mistake. So in Advaita Vedanta, the situation is reversed. What is that? The human mind is only a layer of consciousness, and human mind is the instrument that is possibility to know the totality. So the individual consciousness can be converted to the absolute consciousness, pure consciousness. So this mind, also Sri Aurobindo has also said that there are different types of minds. Mind is dynamic. Every person lives with his or her own mind. Your mind is your world. Your mind and your thought create your world. You live in that world. As your understanding, so is your world. So the understanding is different. We have different mindsets. So there are different layers of consciousness. So in the highest layer of consciousness is Brahman or Atman or pure consciousness. And in the lower layer of consciousness, I am Jiva or ego. And mind is also a layer of consciousness. Buddhi is another layer of consciousness. Mana, buddhi, viveka. All these are the different layers of consciousness. Similarly, in Aurobindo's philosophy, over mind, illumined mind, intuitive mind, super mind. In this way, he has described different types of mind. Like Advaita Vedanta, as Advaita Vedanta did not undermine the human possibility to know the totality, ब्रह्मावीत ब्रह्मेव भवति, द मोमेंट यू नो द ट्रूथ यू बिकम द ट्रूथ. सो आवर कल्चर सेज नोइंग इज बिकमिंग. इफ यू नो यू बिकम, इफ यू नो द ट्रूथ यू बिकम द ट्रूथ. So here knowledge is not a degree, knowledge is not a certificate, knowledge is transformation. If you knew the truth, you become, you have to become the truth. If you know and you don't become, that is not knowledge. So if I know Brahman, I become Brahman. Brahma with Brahme Bhavati, the knower, knowledge and known, they are not three things, they are one. So this mind, has capacity to understand the higher reality. It's very common sense. It is not a speculation, it's not philosophy. We experience that in our daily life. Some students are very intelligent, they can understand, they can do very difficult mathematics, but some others can't. So mind differs in quality, in talent. So the highest talented mind, the highest mind, the highest perfect mind can grasp the higher pervasive reality. This possibility is there in Indian culture. Similarly is the philosophy of Leibniz. Leibniz said that don't limit human mind. Don't limit the nature. Spinoza ended with a beautiful notion of the unmanifest and manifest world, but that was only a notion. That was a very beautiful theory, and Spinoza also admits that my God is not a religious God, my God is an intellectual God. Similarly, this world is an intellectual world. Similarly, the relation between the one and the many is understood intellectually. But Leibniz says this intellectuality and that intellectuality can't give a holistic worldview. By that we can't describe, we can't grasp the whole reality. Therefore, we are bound to conclude that some areas are there, some attributes are there, which are left unknown. Therefore, the noumena is left unknown by Kant. The other attributes of substance are left unknown by Spinoza. The rest of the elephant is left unknown by the blind knower. Leibniz says, nothing can be left out. Nothing can be left out. The reality should be grasped totally. No part of the reality will be left out. We can't ignore this manifested world in the name of substance. Substance is real. That's good. Substance is real, but we can't undermine the particulars. If we do that, then naturally there will be some areas which shall remain unexplained. Now you see, the one unmanifest substance is there, and that is the source of the manifestation of each and every modification. That means one has become many, but the reality is one. Spinoza said, the absolute reality is one. Leibniz says, it is not one, better you say everyone. This is the difference between one and everyone. I am giving an example. In our college, there is one principal. So we say that he is the person, he is one who is the authority of this college. If this concept will go, then the piano will be neglected. The watchman will be neglected because they are watchmen, they are peons, they are always neglected. Because the principal has a separate existence, separate identity, and he is a peon or he is a watchman. He is different from this status. The second philosophy says, now this is the second possibility is the corporate life. In the corporate life, where boss and the staff, they all are same. The second possibility is that not one, but everyone of this college is self-sufficient. For example, now we are dealing with the core banking system, ATM system. You have money in your bank at one place, but wherever you go, you can use the ATM card. That means your banking system is universal. You can make your transaction in any branch. That means whoever is with a laptop, is with a computer system, and if there is network, he can access and he can make transaction of your account. If the manager is there before the screen, he can do. If a assistant manager is there, he can do. If any peon is trained to see the system, to operate the system, then he can also make transaction in your account. That means if the system is there, anybody can operate it, be the manager, be any other staff. The system is same. The mathematics is same. The mathematical truth is truth for all. It does not mean that it is true for a king and it is not true for others. So that is the point. So not one, but everyone is real. Not one reality, but everyone is real. If everyone is not real, this one reality is a misnomer. So don't jump from one to many. As the philosophy of Spinoza is the philosophy of involution. Involution, that one involves into many. Leibniz said, let us start from the particulars. That one, that unity is accepted. That unity in one is found in everyone. Everyone entity is the same entity having all the essences of that one substance. Therefore, Leibniz said that every particular is real. Every particular is real. And he took the help of mathematics. How? In mathematics, the same mathematics has been used by Descartes, Spinoza and Leibniz. Mathematics is the same. But they have understood mathematics and they have applied mathematics from different perspectives. Descartes said that mathematics benefits me to have the self-evident truth, clear and distinct perception. Spinoza said that from the geometry, as some rules remain constant in variations, similarly, the philosophy and the morality should be according to geometrical principles. Similarly, library also followed mathematics, but from different perspectives. What is his understanding of mathematics and which mathematical principles Leibniz introduced in philosophy? The number one is law of continuity. Law of continuity. That in mathematics, we see the number can be extended in both the ways in the infinite regress. That is no point where you can stop, that this is the final number. You can add to the maximum, to the highest. There is no highest. You can go on adding. So the lowest number and the highest number, there is a continuity. This continuity is there. The second continuity is there. Suppose there is a straight line. There is a straight line. The straight line is the continuity of points. All the points are connected to each other with continuity. Therefore, we have a straight line. How can we prove it? Suppose there is a straight line. Just miss one point, one particular. Make it, that point is missing in a straight line. Then it is not a straight line. It becomes two straight lines. So one small point disturbed the continuity, and that changed the status of the straight line. One became two. So one in order to remain one should be continuous in process. Every dot, every point is connected. Therefore, it is a straight line. So there is a motion, there is a movement. The point moves. If there is a break in the movement, if there is a gap, if there is a space, empty space, then it is, the definition changes. We can't say that it is one triangle. The one becomes two. Two becomes three. Three becomes four. If the continuity is lost. Similarly, if the triangles will continue further, it will have different surfaces. We can have a triangle with three straight lines. If there will be a gap between the straight lines, we can say it is a triangle. Similarly, in a circle, there is no gap. There is no missing point. If there is a missing point, we can say that it is a circle. So this continuity is there in mathematics. Now we shall apply this principle in physics and metaphysics. We can apply this principle in our practical life. Today we are celebrating New Year. Happy New Year, Happy New Year, Happy New Year. Is there any discontinuity in time? That at this time, the old year went and the new year came? No, the time is continuous. There is no time as such. We have calculated time. We have calculated the year, month, day, hour, minute, second. This is our conventional calculation. We have done this. But time is a continuous process. So every moment is a new moment. So every year is a new year. Every moment is a new moment. So every moment should be celebrated as a new moment. Every moment is dynamic because every moment is connected with the time eternity. Even by science, we can prove the law of continuity. How? Suppose that there is an electric wire and the current is passing through the electric wire. This is a very scientific example. Suppose there is a break in the, suppose somehow it is cut, then the flow will break. So for the flow of the current, incessantly, continuously, there should not be any break. If there will be any break, then there will be no flow of current. So everything is continuous. Everything is continuous. This is one principle we shall discuss more in the next session. The second principle is law of individuality. This is very, very important. Law of individuality. That every individual is real. Every individual is real. And the law of continuity supplements law of individuality. Take the same example, the straight line. In the straight line, in the straight line, every point is the individual. If one individual is missed, it rejects the status of the straight line. That means every individual point contributes the straight line to be a straight line. Similarly, this body is the entire body. If any part of this body will be infected by cancer, I shall die. That means every part of my body is the whole body. Every part of my body is connected with the whole. It is not this part is infected or this blood cell is infected. No, the entire blood is infected. It can be isolated from the whole. If it can be isolated by logic, that is good. We can isolate in logic. But in reality, we can't isolate it. So what Spinoza did? Spinoza isolated in logic. In logic, we can isolate. In logic, we can have a valid argument from the false propositions. This possibility is there in logic. But in reality, it is not that. In reality, we cannot separate the particular from the whole. If we do so, the integration will be disintegrated. The unity will be disturbed. That means to have a complete clear straight line, every particular point has its own contribution. To have a perfect health, every part of my body should be perfect. Similarly, in moral character, every action should be moral. Not that I am moral in the morning and I am moral in the evening, but after 12, I shall drink and I shall misbehave. No. I am 90% moral, 10% even. No. Moral means 100% moral. If at any point you are immoral, then your whole personality is immoral because that is connected. Suppose there is a white cloth. White cloth. If there will be a black spot at any place, that will be visible and that will cancel the whiteness of the cloth, because all the parts of the cloth is connected. So every individual has its contribution, has its contribution to the whole. No part can be separated from the whole. If it is done so, then that will go against the principle of integration. This is the second principle he borrowed from mathematics and applied in physics and metaphysics. The third principle is the harmony, principle of harmony. Not only each particular has selfless contribution to make the whole as a whole, all the particulars are independent to each other. This is individuality. Individuality means every individual represents the whole, but each individual is independent of the other individuals, because each individual is the whole entity, whole reality. So there are many, but each has a distinct entity, and that distinction is the apparent distinction, because that can represent the whole reality. But the third point is the harmony. In spite of their independent status, they are independent to each other, but there is a beautiful harmony between the particulars. Between the particulars. What our eye does, mouth does not do. What our nose does, belly does not do. All the organs of our body do their respective functions, but they are harmonized by the central system of our body. They are all integrated. They are all harmonized. Similarly, in the melody, melody orchestra party, all the musicians, they play their instruments, and each instrument has its own rule. But when they sing a song, when the music is played, they appear as if there is only one sound, one music. The diversities, the particulars contribute for the unity. So diversities are there, but there is also harmony. He also borrowed this from mathematics. How there is harmony in mathematics? You take any mathematical equation, from that you can solve many mathematical problems, because that is harmonious with the entire mathematical principles. And that is universal in space, time and person. So mathematical principles and principles have harmony. By one equation, we can explain so many big problems in mathematics. Similarly, from taking every particular entity, we can explain the whole universe. Whole universe. And there is a beautiful harmony. Who has created this harmony? We shall discuss in the next session, but at least it should be understood that is harmony. Each particular is real, and each particular is connected with other particulars, and all particulars are well harmonized. So nothing is left unknown and unknowable. For the knowledge of the totality, one should not become the totality. Even one is a part, that part potentially, implicitly contains the whole reality. Exactly, this is the atomic energy in the modern science. Exactly. So just I shall speak only 2 or 3 minutes. I shall conclude. This is an introduction to Leibniz philosophy. In the next session, we shall discuss more. But here, Leibniz, Spinoza gave importance to one, that one abstract substance is there, and these modes are modifications, and there are some areas of ignorance which man cannot know. Immanuel Kant also did that. But Leibniz said that unity is accepted, that one all-inclusive entity is accepted, but that is not one. Everyone has that potentiality. Everyone is a soldier in the battlefields, not the commander-in-chief. Every man has instruments. Every soldier has weapon. Every soldier has his family. Every soldier has his life. Every soldier is dedicated. Is dedicated for fighting for the war. So every soldier should be respected. So from this, the sociological philosophy, the sociological norms comes that every man should be respected. So in the corporal sector, there the boss is equally respected with each and every staff of that company, because they mutually contribute the product. And that is the real meaning of Vasundheva Kutumbakam. That is the real meaning of Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha. If one is the master and all others are modifications, if there is a gap between one and many, then there cannot be any social harmony. Social harmony is possible if all individuals are respected, if all individuals are accepted, all individuals are taken, are honored with dignity. So by this way, Leibniz speaks of both spiritual unity and spiritual diversity. Spiritual unity in the sense, every particular is a unity. Every particular is a unity which can explain the diversity. In that sense, it is the spiritual unity. But everyone is such an entity, and there are multiple organized unity. Every unity represents the totality, and there are multiple unities, so this is diversity. So spiritual unity and spiritual diversity, they are complementary to each other. How? We shall discuss in the next session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your yet another nice lecture. It was very interesting. So you took the way where you left in the last lecture, and you tried to proceed further to see how intellectuality in Descartes, morality in Spinoza takes the shape of spirituality in Leibniz. Now, very nicely, you have said of the transition from Spinoza to Leibniz, when the pantheistic elements that are seen or in Spinoza was totally found a new mark when you asserted that reality is everyone. So from a monistic thread to a sort of reaching a height in the form of pantheism, finally took the shape that every reality is everyone, not reality is one, but reality is everyone. It's a great message for the community to look into the philosophy of Leibniz, wherein you took the principles of individuality or the principle of continuity and the harmony, all serving to prove that reality is not just one, reality is everyone. So it's a great message, and this message proves that if at all there is a spirit, it is flowing continuously, there is a continuity to the world of beings and forms. So without taking the name of, without uttering the idea of monad, directly or indirectly you have spoken that this spiritual unity is flowing through the diversities of forms that we find out there in this world. And during the initial part, you made it very much clear that the essence is already there in the particular. When you took the example of a drop of water from the ocean having the essence of the ocean, or the drop of blood carries the essence of the entire blood of the human being. So very nicely you have articulated the philosophies of Descartes, Spinoza and Leibniz, and very nicely you made a way to the further discussion of philosophy of Leibniz, to see how Spinoza tries to Leibniz tries to arrive at a sort of pre-established harmony wherein everybody is a monad, even the animate world, even the inanimate and the animate, everything is charged with consciousness. Maybe the level of consciousness, the degree of consciousness may vary from one to the other, with the highest consciousness lying in the divine. So what is putting everyone together is the consciousness. So that speaks of the spiritual unity.
Very nicely said, very nicely said, sir. Very Thank nicely
you.
Said.
Thank you. So that speaks of the spiritual unity that Professor Das was trying to point out. So very nicely, very nice things. I have really enjoyed the entire lecture. And so with these words, I should thank the speaker. And many other points he pointed out during the course of the lecture, well, I'll not comment on that. Very nice things he has said. So I see this new year beginning with a great talk by Professor Das. I was learning from Professor Das, I should honestly say. I used to say that after the last lecture, I said it was the best lecture that I have heard from you. Now I say it is a much improved version over the last one. So I should say this new year has really had a very got a very good start, very good beginning with the lecture of Professor Das, and he's the man behind all these activities. And so hoping that this new year will go on fine. So very nice lecture. Thanks everybody. Now if there is any question, let me see in the chat box. I will try to put that before the speaker. Well, there are questions by Sravani Misra. I see, must see godly spirit in every material of the world. That is, yes, that's what Professor Das, yes, Sravani Misra madam says, that there is a spiritual unity, a spiritual unity that we find in everything out there in the world. Well, Professor Das has tried to point it out, and I too made it a point that this is the spiritual continuity that Professor Das is speaking of. By taking, and you took very nicely, you took the help of the law of continuity and the individuality. Every individual is an individual, is real, but at the same time, it is in the flow, it's in the continuity. The continuity is never broken. So there is a spiritual thread, there is a spiritual continuity amidst the diversity, and that spiritual thread puts everyone into one. And that justifies that everyone is real, not that reality is one, rather reality is everyone. This line, reality is everyone, well, I have never come across during my philosophical training. Well, this is the line that I got from Professor Das. So I should thank him for this. And I should also thank Sravani Misra for raising this very beautiful question. Thank you. Well, if Professor Das wants to add something, welcome.
Okay, sir. So today is new year, the 1st January. So if there is no other question, we shall conclude here. So we shall celebrate New Year after this talk. Okay.
Okay. The celebration in the family has already started. It should go on. And tomorrow we are having the webinars to be presented by the research scholars and the PG students and the undergraduate students. We are eagerly waiting for the evening session tomorrow. So you are all invited. Now we request Swarnalata Tripathi Madam to propose a formal vote of thanks. Over to Swarna Madam. Well, let's see some sort of network issue from the side of Shravani Mishra Madam, Shravani Tripathi, Swarnalata Madam.
Harmony in among all particular entity. This new year is not separate from its past and future. Therefore, every moment is new moment, but it is connected with the whole time entity. I wish a very happy new year to Dr. K. Om Narayan Rao sir. Wisdom Intellectual Forum and Philosophy Family are grateful to Dr. Rao sir for his selfless contribution in moderating all sessions of both the forums. We thank all the participants for participating in the discussion. I pray God to bless all of you with love, peace and wisdom. We shall meet tomorrow at 5:30 p.m. in the National Webinar Competition for Students. All are requested to participate in this special occasion. Thanks. Pranam.
Thank you, Swarna Madam. I also thank you from the platform of Philosophy Family for your tireless effort in making this webinar series so successful. So, thanking everybody, may I declare, and also thanking the speaker and the participants, may I declare this meeting closed. Thank you, everybody. Have a good time.